be then embedded into a microchip to form a logical processing system inside a computer. So that is the problem, that it cannot be properly systematized to form a microchip or a transistor, number one. And number two, transportation consumes more energy, and that is the main reason for most of the greenhouse effects of the global system. And now recently, electricity driven cars are there. Like Actera company, it has launched a car in which the panel is on the basis of solar cells. That is, solar panel roof cells are made in that Actera cars, which are going to come, which has a capability to be driven for 190 kilometers, having the natural energy, zero wastage energy into possibility. Likewise, there is one roaster system. There is one roaster company which is releasing this sports car, in which recently they have made such a system to have embedded solar panels, by which, by the cost efficiency of 2 cents per kilometer, they can drive, which is very, very cheap and economical than any other fuel. So such things are there in the move. And third, we are mainly coming into the fuel cells. Fuel cells, they are very clean, perfect and efficient. Naturally, fuel cells are like that. And these fuel cells, they are of different types. You know that there is a positron, that is a proton exchange membrane cell is there. A cell with alkaline is there, phosphoric acid is there, molten carbonate is there, solid oxide is there, direct methanol fuel cell is there. Innumerable such cells are used in the fuel cell technology. Fuel cell technology is very easy, that between two electrodes there is an electrolyte, and this electrolyte creates the electrochemical equivalent of combustion, and without burning it releases energy by pushing the electrons. As it does not burn, it does not give any pollution at all, so it is totally pollution free. And hydrogen fuels, generally they give only water, whereas the fossil fuels, they give H2O plus CO2, carbon dioxide, which is a greenhouse gas. So that is in fuel cell. Fuel cells, we can just, now they are using in NASA, the space shuttles, they are operated by fuel cells. And in Vancouver and Chicago, they have operated, they have tested and operated with the systems which are called as in the transportation devices. And there is a company, US International Fuel Cell Devices company is there. Now they are also planning to make electronic gadgets as well as power stations in H2. The only problem is the membrane as well as the catalyst used are very expensive. To bring down the price, they are doing some measures. That is in fuel cell. Now recently, Dr. Grail Robuster, he has designed that there is a fungus in the ulmo tree, that is a cordyophobia species in ulmo tree, there is a fungus which can create diesel vapor, which can convert plant waste into diesel vapor, and a large amount of effective hydrocarbons such as octane, they have been found. And it is also having a special design of genes which can create enzymes which can break cellulose into diesel vapor. But still, how much productivity can be made, that is yet this process is going on for test to apply the same thing in a moving car, practically viable. This is on fungus. So there is also a possibility of biomass or biofuel through a fungus that has also been made. Then there is also a critical way of analysis made by people known as geoengineering, in which they consider that directly we can contact with the nature instead of mitigation of the global warming and other things, etc. Direct we can chemically contact with the ether as well as the oceanic and earth surfaces. They made 2 attempts which were very hazardous, more hazardous than the global warming itself. It is just throwing tiny sulfur particles into the ether so as to bounce back the sun's heat energy to the ether itself. And second thing is, tiny iron particles are boosted into the oceanic tide, and they think that it will mitigate the global warming system. And now it has been already tested in a limited way, and the results have shown that this iron induces the growth of an algae which produces lot of neurotoxins known as domoid acid. This domoid acid that will totally put an end, that will annihilate the amphibian, the and otherwise the pisces community of the abysmal living. So totally it will enhance the way of destruction more, and it is more hazardous. It is known as geoengineering. What I want to say here is, whatever we are doing in the form of just chemical retaliations for the same chemical compounds which were hazardous, that is not going to be a real solution. We have to think about the long-term effect and benefit. So it is not possible there. So apart from this geoengineering, next to the main thing we are going to attempt is, even in small thing, like there is a sticker. The sticker tape, if it is peeled off and sticked again and peeled off, it releases that X-rays. And if the same thing, instead of electrons, if they are applied towards molecules, they can just adjust and just can accumulate nuclear fusion. But deuterium and the tritium ions, the basic ions, if they are handled in 515 keV in a high energy field, then a fusion may be possible. That energy is so infinitesimal in just a stripping of or peeling of a particular sticky tape, that is very feeble, that is very infinitesimal to produce high levels of energy. Then we are having the nuclear energy, which is the previous speaker, he has very much elaborated. But nuclear energy has no discretion. Civilian and military uses are within the people and it has no discretion. Even radioactive wastage is there, storage has been asked. We can store and we can control the impact of radioactive wastage and hazard. How to deal with the hyperactive non-state reactors who are going to handle that? How we are going to avoid the human hazards of the reactive or radioactive wastage? Radioactive wastage, inherently they can be just stored by a process and they can be handled with safety. But how to do with human these things, unless transformation in civilization and ethical values of users and consumers, unless it comes, there is no usage at all. The second thing is, yes, the second thing is, after this we are having hydro energy. 1/5 of the hydroelectricity produced is going to be a supplement for the whole energy system of the world. And moreover, China is having the three gorgeous project in which it is having 26 turbines, which gives the 18 coal-firing thermal stations power in the turbine itself, producing 3% of the energy demand of China. And even it is known that the Empress of that England, she is getting energy from the Thames by a hydroelectric project. That is also going on. Wind energy is very much to be pondered now, because that is very safe also and availability is also there. Wind energy is certain to be pondered. Now Scotland has the most wonderful and potential wind energy force. US is trying to implant 1/5 of the energy production from the wind energy. Integrated turbines are being made and 19,640 turbines are being constructed in Germany at all. Now China is planning for a 50 gigawatts of energy by 2015. Now Dr. Peter Hope has designed an advanced system of that rotation fan blades, in which we can produce, we can harness more energy. Clipper Company of California, they have made 75 feet or 75 meter large size of blades by which you can get more energy. And the statistical report says clearly that the annual average global wind speed is 106 million gigawatts hour per year, which is more than the 5 times the generation of what we are doing the electricity for now. So we are having 5 times more than what we generate by multiple sources. So wind sources are there, photovoltaic sources are there. Photovoltaic source, now they are going to discuss, and they are very much available. Cheap sources are there. Now flexible coverings in buildings and in shutware, it is going to come to harness more energy. Likewise, we are having geothermal energy, which we are having in Iceland. We are having ocean thermal energy, which is made by Mackay Ocean Engineering.